Of a well-known, of great Polish-Jewish educator who was murdered by Nazis at the beginning of the 20th century, in the middle of the 20th century, Polish educator Janusz Korczak. In his well-known book that is called How to Love a Child, he wrote these words. All wars in the world begin in a nursery. Why? A child that is born in a family where he is waited, still in a time being, finds himself in the situation of interaction with his parents, when he doesn't feel respect towards him. And I tried to answer to the question, how can we avoid this violence in interaction of parents and children? What can be opposite to that violence? To my mind, it can be only a dialogue. And now we ask a question. Is realization of dialogical interaction of parents and children, does it depend on some maybe national specifics of a family? And I'll try to cover the problem of a possibility of a dialogue with a child from the perspective of multicultural Russian society. I'll try to give you examples of how the upbringing of children in the families in Russian families are organized, and does violence depend on those national specifics? So, let us begin with the notion of dialogue. A dialogue in existentialism is not understood as a form of verbal communication. It is understood as method of people's coexistence. As you know, according to humanistic psychology and pedagogy derived from it, the only effective way to reach educational interaction is to create an atmosphere in which an adult and a child can behave naturally, accept each other, seek understanding, and coordinate their actions by means of a dialogue. On this principle, much has been produced by modern Russian educators. Both theoretical and practical writings. They note that this dialogue allows you to make the most of freedom and individual uniqueness of exceeding subjects. I mean subjects by subjects, parents, one subject, and children, another subject. What are the possibilities of a dialogue with a child in the family, in the multicultural society in Russia? The answer to this question is very complex, and it is associated with historical background of parenting. It is, above all, the folk traditions of education, which in Russian society has been paid much attention to. As you know, Russia is a multicultural, multinational state. Its territory is home to more than 180 million nations, while the Russians make above 80% of the population. According to the latest census in the Russian Federation, as many as 111 million people called themselves Russians. The second largest nationality are Tatars. And you are in the center of the Tatars, in the Tatar Republic. 5.31 million. The third place is taken by Ukrainians, who make up 1.93 million. Each nation has developed its own traditions of upbringing, which are reflected in the upbringing of children in modern Russian society. But you should know that there are a lot of families where spouses are of different nationalities. One may be Russian, and the second one is Tatar, or Moldovan, or other nationalities. So we can even see how the traditions of upbringing of children are fancily based on traditions of different nations, of different peoples. However, we can talk about the traditions of education bearing common to all mankind and taking place in many nations of Russia. So in my analysis of the possibility of a dialogue with a child in this report, I will follow the following sequence. First, I will focus on the characteristics of dialogical interaction. Then, introduce some of the features of education according to the traditions of folk pedagogy. And I'll pay particular attention to the Tatar family. I think you understand why. First of all, because me, myself, I have grown up in the Tatar family, in the countryside, in the rural Tatar family. And I should say that the traditions of folk upbringing are followed very carefully, especially in a rural family. And that's why I can give you examples of that upbringing, of my own upbringing in the Tatar family. Secondly, as I told you before, Tatar nationality is the second largest in Russia, and the examples I give here can prove those notes I give you in my report. So let us begin with the characteristics of dialogue. So what is dialogue? According to Buber, a dialogue is I-so relationship. Buber notes that in the way of this relation, there are many obstacles. There are special powers of I-so relation, thinks Buber, which by its very nature cannot achieve full reciprocity. Among these links, Buber calls the interaction of teacher and the pupils, amazing, but it is so, which is alien to the real dialogue, or at least is difficult, as well as the interaction of the priest and the parishioner, doctor and patient. So if we think about priest and parishioner, it is, well, understandable, because we think that priest is some medium between the God and other people, and that's why people are maybe feel a little bit afraid, and the full understanding of priest is, and the parishioner is difficult. And about the doctor and patient, it is also understandable, because the patient comes to doctor because he has some problems with his health. And he's afraid that something is wrong with him, and only the doctor can help him. And that's why he depends on him. That's why we can't talk about the full understanding of the patient and the doctor. But it was very astonishing to me that Buber thought that that interaction of the teacher and the pupil, the full understanding between them, is also very difficult and can't be fulfilled absolutely. Why? Why does it happen? I think that this happens because many educators, as well as parents, stick to authoritarian methods in bringing up children. So when we return to the family, the parents claim the primacy of parental authority over the children. Parental authority historically represented from a form of property right. Children obey the rule of a father as if they are slaves and form a number of subordinated persons, children. The power of householder merges the power of a father and a husband, because originally the wife served only as a subservient person. The father has the right to life and death of their children, to their freedom. This right is found in all nations as it existed in the old Russian way of life. Authoritarian parenting was typically associated with traditional patriarchal family. Such, for example, was the Cossack family. The head of the family was the man who was the only owner and disposer of family budget, who made decision on the separation of the sons and daughters in marriage, even starting their own families. Adult sons and daughters obeyed their father, who could interfere with their personal lives. It was so in the old Russian traditions. If we turn to Tatar families, so the head of the Tatar family was always also the man, a father, a husband, or, if father died, the eldest son. They owned the whole family. They had full power over their actions and followed the instructions to the rest of the family, so to all the children. The children's right to voice their opinion could not have been even considered. Many Tatar families, especially in rural areas, even today, acknowledge a complete father authority. At the same time, it should be noted that in the Tatar folk pedagogy, educational impact was rooted in the authority and personal example of the adults. Authority of parents played a strikingly important role in building up the morality of children. The basis for parental authority was a rich experience which they passed up on their children, parental love and care about children. The role of parents in children's upbringing was always very huge, and it is so up to date in Tatar families. This is brightly shown in many popular sayings. For example, если уж молоко матери не...
If the mother's milk, if the mother's milk is not good for him, the cow's milk all the more.
Children got a sense of deep gratitude for caring parents who raised them. Therefore, people said, родители золотые крылья. Ата она алтын канат. Parents are golden wings. The strength of parental influence on children is closely linked to a friendly understanding between members of the family, their relationships. Mutual assistance in the family, mutual support are important for complete happiness in the future. So let us turn to the next characteristics of the dialogic relations. An important component of dialogic relations is the adoption. A warm attitude to the child as a person who has absolute value independent of his state, behavior, and feelings. happiness and well-being of children depends entirely on the degree of love and acceptance that they receive. It is enough to be always on the side of the child and let him feel it. Folk pedagogy speaks about it and calls these feelings of parents chadolubia, which can be translated as love to a child, but it is love like one word connected together. Birth of a child has always been a happy and long-awaited event in the life of the family. And you know that 2 days ago I became a granny, and that was really a very long awaited event, and we are, with my husband, are absolutely happy because of the birth of our granddaughter. Therefore, love for children and caring for them are bright humanist tradition of all peoples in Russia. Views of various peoples of Russian to nurture are basically the same. The humanism of folk pedagogy requires love to a child, care for it, care for and creating conditions for him to develop his skills and abilities. Folk pedagogy assigns a special role of parental, especially maternal love, attention and care in the development of the child. The people saw parental love as the greatest and irreplaceable source of spiritual development of the child, his emotions, moral values, self-confidence. Parental love is a precondition and an inexhaustible source of responsiveness, sensitivity, care, and love for the people and other generous human feelings. Folk educators believe parental love is the basis of upbringing in the family, as there is great power in paternal and maternal feelings. Parental love, tenderness and affection, trust and respect for children, allowing them to independently create a warm atmosphere in the family, to have a revelation that undoubtedly all these contribute to the positive parental impact of children. Attention and love for children is reflected in many traditions, in the works of different genres of folklore. The following sayings express a warm parental child care and love for them. Своё дитя и медведь называет беленьким, и ёж называет мягоньким. Үз баласын аю да аппағымдай, кірпі де юмшағымдай. Even a bee calls his child fair, and a hedgehog calls soft. Думы матери о ребенке, а думы ребенка о степи. Она күңілі балада, бала күңілі далада. The mother's thoughts are about a child, and the child's thoughts are in the steppe. A child growing up under conditions of abundant love, affection, and encouragement will seek to develop a positive attitude towards life and sustainable principles in early childhood. A child being brought up in criticism and punishment will grow fearful, suspicious, distrustful. That may create potential personal problems, which are sure to emerge later in adult life. Adults with low self-esteem were indeed deprived of love and safety in childhood, all of which are so much important during the formative years. Dialogue implies absolute acceptance of the child, respect for the full range of his feelings, regardless of whether they are positive or negative. This means that you like it and you take it, every bit of his inner world. Only this creates a sense of warmth and safety in a child. In relationships with adults, a kind of safety that is so important to establish is a helping relationship. So, if you look at this feature, of dialogue in the national pedagogy, you can see that people always condemned parents who petted their children too much and constantly praised them, warning. Если ребенка слишком ласкают на коленях, потом он доставит много хлопот. If the child... put on his knees, then he will bring a lot of troubles. Encouraging children does not disregard firmness and demanding in education. People definitely condemn pampering children, indulging their whims, prove their strength of parental image. Folk wisdom warns against unreasonable love, supposing that it could lead to the development of self-love, arrogance, and over-high self-esteem, and consequently to a selectivity in communicating with people. Избалованный мальчик становится волком, избалованная девочка – глупышкой. A spoiled boy becomes a wolf, a spoiled girl becomes a fool. There is still a tendency of showing less feelings in the Tatar families. It was believed that children should not be too petted, especially by their father. Many Tatar families still have a so-called hierarchy of relationships, which means that children prefer asking from their mothers, who then addresses their will to fathers. In modern family, we continue the tradition of pushing the authority of the father. When I remember myself in my childhood, I also remember that it was the last person in the family whom I could address, I mean my father, because first I had to solve all the problems with my mom, discuss it with her, and if there were some very difficult situations, only then we discussed that with my dad. And I always felt that this responsibility for me, responsibility for a family, it was my father's main cause. And at the same time, I always felt that I longed for his tenderness. I couldn't feel that tenderness every time. I felt the tenderness from my mother. And when I was ill, for example, if my dad came to me, put his hand on my head and said, oh, do you feel bad? You can't even imagine how happy I was because my dad asked that. These kind of relationships is really very typical to rural families, Tatar families. Certainly, when we speak about today's youth and today's young families, this tradition isn't followed. And I think that my son, who became a father 2 days ago, will show all his tenderness to the newly born girl. And that tradition of my father, of his dad, of his grandfather, won't be a rule for my son. Human activity and the need for self-improvement are development, human activity and the need for self-improvement are developed under conditions of relating with other people, built on the principle of a dialogue. So we should talk about dialogue not only in the relationships with parents, with educators, but with other people too. It is not just an exchange of verbal statements, but it is first and foremost characteristic of partner relationships in the dialogue based on equality, emotional openness, and trust for another person, that is accepting him as a valuable one in one's inner world. The Tatar children were taught such relations with each other in the family. Traditionally, Tatar family was a big one. There were a lot of children. And respect for elders in the traditional pedagogical traditions imply respect for older brothers and sisters as well. You should know that the elder sister or brother is called Apa, or abi, that means a sister and a brother, in a very respectful way. You don't call your brother or sister by name, but you call him apa or abi, and this is the way of showing the respect to the elder one in the family. And the children who are born earlier, they also feel that responsibility of those who are born later. And in the Tata folk pedagogy, elder brother is spoken about with special respect and love. It is an ancient custom. The elder brother always helps teachers and, if necessary, protects and supports. The older children are able to babysit younger because parents, being busy with household duties, often make them look after the child. The elder children are able to entertain the younger ones, tell stories, feed, put to bed. From their mothers, they hear lullabies and sing them, lulling their little brothers and sisters. And as I told you, if father is person number one in the family, and if something tragical happens in a family to the father, so then the elder brother becomes takes the role of a father. And I can give you as an example my own father. His my grandfather died very early. He was only 37 years old. And in the family consisting of five children, he was the eldest one. And I could see throughout my whole life that my father was the only person whom his whom his sisters came all the time when they had their problems. It was he who solved all those problems. And this is a tradition in Tata families. Older brothers and sisters play the pedagogical role. Looking at his elder brother is growing the younger brother. Looking at the elder sister, the younger sister is growing. Younger children should be subject to more experienced elders, listen to their advice. The people condemned the family in which one could not tell where they had their head and where they had their feet. At the same time, in many people's families, since early age, children were accustomed to take care of the younger ones. In such families, there is most successful harmonious blend of humanism and rigor, respect and integrity, love and wisdom, mutual aid and self-reliance. During the absence of all adults caring for younger assigned to elder children, especially girls, folk educators believed that with his younger brother, rest will be, with an elder sister, the mind will be. A dialogue in education presupposes respect for the child, avoiding penalties, and a sense of proportion in the use of incentives. This problem of penalties, is one of the most important problems of avoiding violence in family relations. To use or not to use penalties in the family. What shows the harmonious relationships in the family? If you don't use penalties at all, so how can you solve the problems of their being inobedient, and so on? And I think the problem was actual relevant for all families, not only in the Russian society. At the same time, penalties is a litmus test that characterizes the style and character of adults and children. Pedagogy does not eliminate coercion, censure, prohibition, rebuke, and even punishment for large and severe recurrent misconduct, lying, stealing, swearing. At the same time, any negative impact on a child is always a hidden threat for adults to fall into a stage of passion, anger, or rage, which may lead to unfair, unreasonable, and exaggerated punishment. Based on this, on his educational experience, the people want «Злоба нож ум рука» – «Anger is a knife, mind is hand». «Злость придет, ум уйдет, ум придет, злость уйдет». «Anger comes, the mind goes, the mind comes, anger goes away». Before you punish a child, become, fully consider the situation, determine its cause, and only then select the appropriate punishment. Семь раз отмерь, один раз отрежь, score twice before you cut once. And I gave here the English version of this proverb, but in Russian it sounds score not twice, but seven times, and only then cut. So in folk pedagogy, there is also a place even for, there is a place even for corporal punishment. However, we cannot say that all nations were unanimous in battering. And I should say, there are some peoples in Russia who have no physical violence at all. This is a tradition in those nations. I mean the Tuva, the Mordovians, and the Chuvashes. For example, the Chuvash advised, лучше, чем ударить ребенка, ударь по столбу. Столбу не больно, а тебе больно, а вось задумаешься. Better than to hit a child, hit the pole. A pole doesn't hurt, it hurts you. Perhaps you will think over. In Mordovians, based in Mordovians' organization of family life, it is not based on fear and physical power. Tatar folk pedagogy rejects the use of corporal punishment too. Thus, the promoter Tatar folk pedagogy Kayum Nasuri wrote that intelligent teacher, educator, will be able to educate their children without abuse and beatings. In folk pedagogy, education of children was conducted mainly by positive methods. Corporal punishment is used rarely and only for great offenses, but not discouraged. Чего нельзя вдолбить словом, того и палкой не вдолбишь. Why cannot drum word? And that is not a stick drum.